Before we get started into this series called Christian, would you take a moment and pray with me as we jump into God's Word? Thank you so much for the words that you wrote in your Bible. We ask that you would speak to us, speak directly to our hearts, to our minds. Speak to our Monday. I pray that we walk out of here changed. You say that your word never returns void. Well, God, change me. Change me. As I look at this verse, I just pray that you just change me. Change my heart. Make it look like yours. And may I walk out of here loving people better than I did before. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, amen. Well, if you're new to Soma, I want you to know that we're in a series called Christian, and that's not like a celebratory term anymore. The term Christian is actually a term that non-Jesus people used to describe Jesus people in the Bible. But Jesus people never describe themselves as Christians. You know what they describe themselves as? Disciples, yes, disciples. They describe themselves as disciples because the word disciple means learner, pupil, follower. You know, those type of things. You can be a disciple of a teacher. You can be a disciple of a small group leader. You can be a disciple of whatever, somebody you want to be a disciple under. But the word Christian was not like a positive term back then. They would use that term to describe those Jesus people that we are trying to kill. Like, yeah, well, those Christians, those little Christs. That's how they use the term in the Bible. But the funny thing is that term Christian turned into something that described the people, apparently, that sometimes show up to Soma. But if you were to talk to the people in your school, talk to the people at your work, and you ask them, ask the non-Jesus people, what comes to your mind when you hear the word Christian? What would they say? You can answer. Judgmental, what else? Hypocrite, what else? Homophobic, critical, fake, sexist, Republican, all the above. Right, and that's not exactly what Jesus had in mind when he called you or some of us in here to follow him. Here's exactly what Jesus had in mind. John 13:35, it's not on your papers, but you can write it down. It says, "By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." See, love is predominantly the characteristic of a Christ follower. And tonight we're going to ask the question, is that the characteristic of your life, regardless of the language you use? Is love the predominant characteristic of your life? Because that's what describes a Christ follower. That's what describes a disciple. And the interesting thing about love, the way Jesus uses it, it's messy, it's confusing, it's unfair. It really is. John chapter 1:14. This is John as in one of the apostles, John, not John the Baptist. He is sitting down, finally writing his account of what he saw Jesus do and say. And in John chapter 1, it really is the overture. It really is the context in which he sees Jesus' love. And he says this about Jesus, which is really interesting to me, and it's about his love. Now listen close. It's John 1:14. It says this. "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." Let me unpack that for a second. John is looking back about his encounter with Jesus. And he said, and he's writing to a Roman Greco context, Roman Greco audience, and he's saying the Word became flesh. Why would he refer to God as the Word? Why would he refer to Jesus as the Word? Well, that's because ancient Roman philosophers believed that God would reveal himself through his words, called the Logos, where we get the word logic from. That God would manifest himself logically through his words. And John is saying clearly, the Word became flesh. Now this Logos, God, the divine Logos, took on humanity. It's as if you were going outside and like, I was like, hey, don't forget your scarf, Kelly. And you're like, oh yeah, I gotta put this on, it's chilly. And you go into this environment, but you have to be prepared for this environment, right? So divinity took on humanity and dwelled among us. That means he entered into our experience. Well, not just our experience, now it became his experience. So far, so good. You tracking with me? So the divinity took on humanity and entered into this world. And it says, we have seen his glory. Now, he's not talking about we in here because maybe we have not seen it. He's talking about we as in him and the other 11 guys that walked with Jesus. It's not we, it's he. And if we're going to love the way Jesus loved, then how did Jesus love? It says this, full of grace and truth. Not part of grace and truth, not 50% of grace, 50% of truth. He was full of grace and truth. When you look, he embodied fully grace and truth. I don't know if you guys can see it, but you have to look at the podcast and see it later. But, the way Jesus loved was messy, inconsistent, unfair, and confusing. Because when we think about grace and truth, sometimes we feel like we have to sacrifice one in order to have the other, especially when it comes to talking to people, talking to crowds of people sometimes. We feel like we have to sacrifice the truth or sacrifice grace. But when you have a graceless truth, you have flattery. You have nothing. When you have a truthless grace, that's when you have nothing. But when you have a graceless truth, that's when you have destruction. So far, so good? So when you have grace without truth, you have flattery. When you have truth without grace, you just have destruction, damage. You become harsh. So Jesus goes on and confuses me even more with the way he chooses to love people. And maybe you've been confused by Jesus' love for people. It's weird because there's like a few stories in the Bible where I've been like, what? Is it grace or is it truth? Pick one. Which one is it? Yeah. What's the Samaritan? You guys remember the Samaritan woman? The Samaritan woman, right? And there's a story in the Bible with this, 12 disciples are walking down through Samaria. They didn't have to go through Samaria, but Jesus knew what was up. So he goes down through Samaria, and he ends up talking to a Samaritan woman. In a very chauvinistic culture, it's very wrong to be talking to a woman, let alone a Samaritan half-breed woman, at this well. And so Jesus shows her grace and sits down and talks to her in the middle of the day. No one's around, and he's not even afraid that someone's going to catch him. But then he gives her truth and says, go get your husband. Oh, that's right. You don't have a husband. In fact, you've had 5 failed marriages, and the person you're sleeping with now is just, a study buddy. But I know what that means. And so Jesus gives her truth. But then Jesus gives her grace again because she was the first person that Jesus revealed his true nature to as Messiah. And she went away as one of the first evangelists because she heard grace and she heard truth. The other story that comes to mind is the calling of Matthew. the tax collector. You guys know that story, right? Raise your hand if you've ever heard that story before. Cool. Most of you guys, great. If you haven't heard the story, it's awesome. Read the book of Matthew. See, Matthew was a tax collector, but he wasn't always a tax collector. He grew up as a good Jewish boy, and one of the, you know what Jewish boys want to do when they grow up? They want to become rabbis. Yeah, you've heard this one before. But you know what? He failed out of rabbi school. Me and Matthew have a lot in common. We both had ADHD, and like we couldn't sit still, and we couldn't make it through rabbi college. And so we didn't get picked. So we chose different jobs. Unfortunately for Matthew, he chose to be a tax collector, which ended up making him compromise some of the values that he had growing up as a Jewish boy. And the thing about tax collectors and sinners, have you heard that term before, tax collectors and sinners? Thank you. Tax collectors and sinners, they weren't even allowed to be in the same category because tax collectors were so bad. They had a different category. They weren't bad enough to be a sinner. They were worse. So Matthew changed his name to Levi. Better yet, the Jewish community would rather have it that way than to admit that one of their own was a traitor. And Jesus is going out looking for the next rabbi assistant. Jesus is out looking for the next disciple. And he thinks to himself, self? This guy'll do. This tax collector at this toll road named Levi. And we'll change his name back to Matthew. It'll all work out. And the other apostles are like, what? We can't be seen with this guy. And Jesus is like, no, I'll do you even better, solid. Like, we're not only going to hang out with this guy, we're going to go to a party at his house, and we're going to hang out with all of his friends. Grace and truth is so confusing. The way Jesus chooses to love us and Jesus chooses to love these people is sometimes unfair. Doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense how Jesus is crucified between two thieves, or at least that's the story we heard, right? Jesus being hung on a cross between two thieves, but it actually wasn't two thieves because thieves don't get crucified. You have to be so much worse than a thief to be crucified. These two criminals were on a cross because they couldn't even be trusted to be slaves. And one criminal says, we deserve this. We're going to die. And it's because of it's our fault. And Jesus is on the cross saying nothing to that. In his silence, he agrees with the sinner's confession. Truth. But Jesus then replies, today, wherever I'm going, you're coming with me. You're going to be with me in paradise. And I'm like, that's not fair. How does he get in with only 1 minute on the clock? And this guy, Nicodemus, like two chapters earlier, was sent away because he didn't want to give away his stuff? How does that make sense? Have you ever thought that? Am I the only one? I'm like, how does he got, you know, the guy on the cross, he gets in? So, this grace and truth thing, God is calling us to love like that. He's calling us to love like that, and I don't know what it looks like, but I think the greatest example of what that looks like in the Bible is this last passage that I'm going to draw your attention to. And that's in John chapter 8. And you guys are familiar with the woman who was caught in adultery. She was caught in adultery. That is a bad day for her. So let's go ahead and read God's word and see what this looks like. At dawn, he appeared again. He, as in Jesus, appeared again in the temple courts where all the people gathered around him. He sat down to teach them. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group and said, Jesus, teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. Now, what do you say? They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis for accusing him. But Jesus bent down and started to write in the ground with his finger. When they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, "Let any of you who is without sin cast the first stone." Again, he stooped down and kept writing on the ground. At this, those who heard began to go away, one at a time, the oldest to the youngest, until Jesus was left with the woman still standing there. Jesus straightened up and asked her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" "No, sir," she said. "Then neither do I condemn you." Jesus declared, "Go now and leave your life of sin." All right, let's get into this one. Grace and truth all over the place. Doesn't even make sense to me. So confusing. Let's start from the top. At dawn, he appeared again in the temple courts where all the people gathered around him, and he sat down to teach them. All right, so you get the scene, right? It kind of can look like this, right? This is a temple. This is a religious institution that Jesus is at. Think about it. A religious institution that Jesus is at, and somebody comes through the door with a half-naked girl saying, "Hey, what are you going to do with this one?" In the middle, like he's just in the middle of a story, probably. I don't know what he's teaching him. I don't know. Your guess is as good as mine, but probably wasn't this. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought a woman caught in adultery. Now pause. In order to catch somebody in adultery, where would you actually have to be? Oh, sorry. It says caught in the act of adultery. You would have to be there watching. Yeah, I know. Exactly. And these are Pharisees, religious leaders, and teachers of the law. Something shady is happening. Clearly. I'll continue. They made her stand before the group. Oh. Man, I don't even know if her eyes are open at this point because she's probably so incredibly embarrassed. And the last place she probably ever wanted to be, it was inside a religious institution, hanging next to Rabbi Jesus. And they made her stand before the group and they said to Jesus, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. The truth of the law of Moses says to execute her." That's what truth says. "But what do you say, Jesus?" The interesting thing about this part is that if they enacted the Mosaic law in this particular case, the Roman government would have a fit, because the Jewish people are not allowed to enact any type of execution without Roman government being involved. Make sense so far? And so if Jesus says, "Yeah, go ahead and kill her," right? Jesus would become the enemy. But if he says, "Don't kill her," then he looks like he's a heretic going against the Mosaic law. Jesus, what you gonna do? Let's find out. Okay, just real quick. Aren't there people out there just looking for you to fail? I mean, seriously, yesterday, I was watching this guy on a bicycle, and I just put my phone out just in case he fell. I just knew something was going to happen, and sure enough, he did. But well, there's a lot of people around. I'm like, okay, this guy's brain is not fully developed yet. And so I'm like, I'm going to totally keep my phone out. So if you want to see the video, come see me later. But there's something in all of us that usually anticipate the failure of others. And there's something about when we watch other people fail. Like, fail blogs are so popular, aren't they? I spent like hours on one once, just like watching people, like, you know, like kids falling off of swings and stuff like that. It's just something that just tickles you. You know, when that happens, But there's something in us that's drawn to that. And these Pharisees are like grade eight haters, right? That's just what they are, right? They are waiting for people to fail. And actually, they were waiting for Jesus to fail. And they were using this girl as a pawn. And I think the truth out of this particular part of Scripture that I want to point out is that when people are waiting for us to fail, Jesus is not. He is our ultimate advocate when people are trying to accuse you. Verse 6 says, but Jesus bent down. First of all, pause. This is clearly a trap. Jesus, like, his teaching, they're expecting him to, like, totally, like, what are you doing? This girl, just put some clothes on her. Like, please, like, I got a congregation here, clearly. Jesus is expected to act out emotionally. They're expecting to throw him off his game by doing some crazy spectacle like this. But instead of acting out, instead of reacting, look how he acts. He says, but Jesus bent down and started to write on the ground with his finger. He became an advocate. He became an advocate. Turn to the person and say, advocate. Advocate. Another word for advocate is a friend. A friend. A friend. There's two types of people. And actually, I was in the shower today. You guys mind if I go like 10 minutes longer than I normally do? Sure? Okay, cool. Thanks. It's going to be a minute. But there's two types of people. There's the accusers, and then there's the advocate. We just talked about the accusers. Now, the advocates, they try to make friends out of people who are clearly insufficient of being a friend. Like, I was at Starbucks today, and I want the guy to put honey in my cup. This is the biggest pet peeve, that I'm paying you to make my drink, and I just want honey in my drink, but instead of cutting it and putting it in the drink, he hands me the honey packets. Oh, are you kidding me? I'm giving you $5. And I don't have a sink, and I don't have an apron, and I don't have scissors. What are you giving me that for? I told him, I want 4 packets. So in my mind, this guy became a friend to an enemy real fast, right? In my mind, I was accusing him. I'm like, this guy does not even deserve to work here. Take that name badge off. Let me talk to your boss. Like, in my mind, this guy, like, he needs to work at, you know, Coffee Bean or something, but he does not need to work here, because they teach you how to make good tea. So I was accusing him. And then I realized, I have to preach on this tonight. And then, so I'm like, in my mind, I'm like, he's just doing his job. He's just following protocol. Like, he doesn't want to get his hands sticky just as much as I don't. It's okay. I'll drink it without honey. No thank you. I know, there's a little bit of sass there, but I was doing my best to be his advocate. Okay? Like, so I'm making excuses for somebody who I think is violating me. So far, understanding? Right? I'm advocating for my accuser, or for the person I am accusing. At least I felt that way. Or have you ever got a ticket, like a speeding ticket or a ticket from a police officer? Raise your hand. Or you're probably too ashamed to raise your hand, right? Every time I get pulled over, I'm like, oh, man, these cops are just trying to, you know, it's because I'm black and all these other things. Right? I'm just like making up excuses. I'm just like accusing, like, the, you know, there's something wrong with the whole thing. Like, oh, the whole system's messed up. Man, I'm going to go move to Canada, right? Like, I'm accusing. You see that? That's the accusing part that happens within me. And then I have to switch off. I'm like, man, if I'm ever in trouble, I would be very happy to have some police officers help me out. I'm so glad I have police officers that are keeping, you know, if I had a daughter who was speeding, please, Jesus, pull her over, right? Right? I would want that. And I have to, like, advocate for the people I would be accusing. And Jesus advocates by stooping down. In the moment that Jesus stoops down, That's when she starts to feel safe. The moment Jesus stoops down, that's when she's surprised that he is not accusing her anymore. So he stoops down, he starts writing in the sand, totally ignoring the question. Totally ignoring the question. Verse 7 says this. They kept questioning him. What are you going to do, Jesus? What are you going to do? What are you going to do, Jesus? And Jesus is just doing, I don't know, like making smiley faces in the sand. I don't know. They kept questioning him. And then eventually, he stood up and said to them, if any of you are without sin in this situation, let him throw the first stone. Pause. Let me tell you what that means. This doesn't mean just because you don't have sin. You know, anybody who's perfect, then you can judge. That's not what that means. That doesn't mean that you can't judge people because you're not perfect. That's not what this means. Clearly, there is some shady business going on, because in the law, for this to be enacted, you need two eyewitnesses to see them do the deed, not just like walk out of a room together or not just lay down. Like, there needs to be absolute positive evidence that their bodies couldn't be doing anything other than that. So far, so good? I don't need to explain, right? You guys get that. All right, we're good. All right, so you guys had like eighth grade health. You guys understand. Failed it too. So the only person that can enact this type of judgment is the person who saw it. So he's pretty much saying, hey, the person who actually saw this, come up here. Come up here and, you know, flip the switch on the electric chair on this girl. Hey, come up here and inject the poison. If that's you, anybody? He who is guilty, he who is without sin in this situation, because I know it's not an innocent situation. This is definitely a setup. Come on up here. Be the executioner. And then one by one, they started to leave. They started to leave. The oldest to the youngest. I understand that lawbreakers are not qualified to enforce God's law, but the reality is that the lawbreakers in this situation were not qualified to enforce God's law. Jesus doesn't call his followers to constantly be pointing out the truth in people's lives without grace. He calls you to love people with grace and truth, and he shows that to this woman. And lastly, in verse 10, Jesus straightened up. Oh, yeah, neither do I condemn you. I already said that part. Oh, I want to bring this up. This is good. Verse 10. Jesus straightened up and asked her, woman, where are they? I like that Jesus' only question he asks is, where are they? Has no one condemned you yet? No, sir, she says. Then neither do I condemn you. Grace. Go and sin no more. Truth. See, condemnation is interesting because it means it's unredeemable. Unredeemable. So I was in, not North Carolina. Where was I at? New Orleans? Thanks, hon. New Orleans. That's my wife. I just don't want you to think I was like, you know, calling Caitlin, hun. That would be weird. I was in New Orleans, and I was driving past the wreckage of Hurricane Katrina. And I was looking past all these houses, and there's this, like, yellow tape that just says condemned, condemned, condemned. And the houses don't look too bad. But I do realize that these houses are unredeemable, according to the definition. And the only way that you can restore this house is by breaking it down to its foundation and then building up a whole new one. Even the foundation might even be messed up. And so the thing about it is I was like, man, these houses are awesome, man. I wish I had a house. What if I just moved in and see what happened? Like, that would be kind of crazy. It would be dangerous, right? Right. The potential of this house collapsing on you is very, very, very high. And that's what sin does. It builds a house that will eventually fall on us. And God wants to free us from the condemnation that comes with sin. John 3:17 says, I have not come to condemn the world, but save the world. That's Jesus talking. There's a story I want to share with you about what it means to be an advocate, to show grace. I was at the Yard House, I don't know, it was a few years back, and my friend came, like, I have this friend that I talk on and off again with, and he used to come to Rocky Peak with me, and then when I moved to Orange County, I stopped being in touch with him, and then I caught up with him one day. He just wanted to meet me for dinner, and he was, like, nervous, and we were at the Yard House, and I was, like, trying the steak, and it was so good. And my friend was really nervous. And I was like, what's up, man? He's like, man, I got to tell you something. I'm like, what? I need to tell you the truth about who I am. I was like, what do you mean, man? He's like, well, since the last time we hung out, I got a boyfriend. And I'm like, okay. I'm like, pass the ketchup. Like, yeah. And so he's like, well, I want to tell you that because I know what you believe about, you know, gay relationships and you know, the gay community. And I just want you to know that I'm gay too. I'm like, all right. Like, tell me about your boyfriend. He was like looking at me and is expecting me to like react or respond. Like, what are you going to do? Like, are you going to accuse me? I just kept eating my pepper steak, and it was really good, and the thing is, he felt safe. At the end of that conversation, I asked him, "What did you expect from me? Like, why were you so nervous? What did you expect? You know, and what do you think I believe about gay relationships?" And he's like, "Well, I know that the Bible says this." I'm like, "Yeah. That's true, but I still love you, and I don't see you as a gay person anyways. I don't care how you identify yourself. I see you as a child of God, and I saw you as a child of God before you told me you were gay, and I see you as a child of God now." And so he said, well, this is the last thing I remember him telling me was that he saw me as a safe person. Even though he knew I didn't agree with his actions or his behaviors, he knew that I believed in him. And he saw me as a safe person, and we're still friends now. And when he's ready to come back to church, I'm hoping that he'll sit in one of these seats one day.
Jesus, give me a battery. Jesus calls us to love. He just calls us to love the way he loved us, with grace and truth. Not part of grace, not part of truth. You don't have to sacrifice one for the other. Jesus came and he embodied all of grace and all of truth in our relationships and in our church. So I want you to think of this as Jesus.
He's just one big Arnold Palmer. There we go. So I could be at church all day and talk about grace, and you guys can be like, amen, awesome, I like Mr. Gracie. But Mr. Truthy, I don't like Mr. Truthy so much. But the reality is, when you are true, when you are honest, when you are completely honest with your sin and your successes and your doubt, guess what? God is not surprised. He's not surprised, right? It's not like you sin and you made a mistake, and he's like, oh, my bad. I didn't mean to save her. I'm going to save him instead. But it's not. That's not the case. In fact, the more honest you are with him, the more grace you can actually experience. I experienced this when I got married, and I don't expect you guys to understand this until later, but the more honest I was with my wife, the more love I can experience. And there's three things that I told my wife before we got married, before we got engaged. And I don't recommend that you do this until you're about to get engaged. And I know there's a lot of people. Well, actually, the more honest up front, the better. I mean, the sooner that you can dodge a bullet, the better. The sooner that you can make a decision. But I don't recommend you being like too overly vulnerable, at least within like the first like 2-3 months. But that means if you are not going to be vulnerable like that, that means your physical expressions of commitment should match. All right? So keep the physical expressions of commitment to a minimum until you're ready to make a bigger commitment. Anyways, that's a different topic for February. Three things I told my wife that she needed to know before she married me. The first thing was that I was going to be in ministry full time, and the extent of my financial success may not exceed living in an apartment and having a minivan. Like, that's the extent of my success at that point. We were walking back from the 99-cent store. It's actually the Asian 99-cent store called Daiso. Anybody heard Daiso? Yeah, you do. I love that place. Right? It's like, wow, just when 99 cents couldn't get awesome, it did. Daiso exists. So we're walking in the parking lot, and I'm like, hey, hon, there's a couple things that you need to know about me before you make a decision whether you want to continue to date me or even get engaged. Because we were talking about engagement and stuff. We were at that point in our relationship. I'm like, first thing, you just need to know that I'm not the money-making guy. I'm not the guy that's like overly concerned with stability. All right, I'm willing to do whatever God wants me to do anywhere he wants me to do it. But I'm not like crazy like, oh, I just got a message from the Lord. We're going to Ungabunga, Africa. Like, it's not crazy. It wasn't like that. It was more like, Like I knew that God had called me to America because I did the Africa thing already. So, and some of you guys still need to do the Africa thing and then figure that out and then come be an intern. So the first thing, I just needed her to know that, like, stability, finances, that's just not me. I'm not that guy. And I'm not very handy. So we have two big problems, but because I have to hire a handyman to get things done. So, but there's that one thing. The second thing I told her is that I'm really, 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 really needy. Like, you guys know this already. I love being around people, and I require lots of attention. And that's just me. Like, that's just me. And I'm ashamed of that. Like, I don't, like, love being a narcissist. And so, like, I really, really don't want that to be a part of my life. And I've gotten better. But she needed to know that's a struggle of mine, and that's who I am, if you haven't figured it out already. Which she knew. It's like coming out, and everyone's like, yeah, I know. Okay, the third thing is a little bit more serious than the first two. That's usually how I like to start, like when you ask mom for something, like you start with like light and then you get heavy and then you're like, hey, you know. Like this one kid is like, hey mom, like I got my girlfriend pregnant. What? No, just kidding. I just need $300. Oh, okay. Like $300 sounds a lot better when you start there, right? Anyways, the last thing. So I told her about ministry. I told her about like just my insecurities, and then I told her about my my struggle with porn. And the word struggle is a light word. I was addicted to porn, and God delivered me, and He's still delivering me to this day, and I get to celebrate in victory right now. But I shared that with her, and I realized like if it wasn't if I was hiding that, I would believe that I was not fully loved, because the truth of who I was not expressed. Nobody knew who I was. But Michelle finally knew who I was, and she decided to love me despite that. Now, that may not be your experience. It just was mine. But if it's not your experience, even after being honest with a person and they decide that that's a liability they cannot accept, please trust that God is freeing you from a relationship that is not in His will. Okay? We're going to invite the band up as we conclude. I hope as a result of tonight's message, you've understand the reason, the way God wants us to love. With grace and truth, not one or the other, both happening at the same time. And yes, it's confusing. Yes, it's unfair. And yes, it's inconsistent sometimes. But that's the way God chose to love the woman at the well, Matthew, and the woman that was caught in adultery, for the sole purpose of freeing you from condemnation. The condemnation that we put ourselves in sometimes, created by our own sin. We have a prayer corner. And if you're struggling with this, if you walked in here, I mean, it may have taken you courage to walk in here today, because you're struggling with what God thinks about you. And you're like, man, I'm just going to give this God thing just a try. I'm going to show up to Soma and hear some random dude speak. But maybe God is speaking to you, and I invite you to join our prayer partners over there in the corner and let them pray for you. You don't even have to tell them what it is about. Just say, I just need prayer. But maybe you do have a burden, but you don't have to leave here with one, right? We don't want you to carry your burdens alone. We want you to experience truth and grace. And maybe at the same time. And like the Samaritan woman, who was caught in her sin, Jesus didn't condemn him or her, and Jesus is not going to condemn you, but He will give you the strength and the power to go out of here and not have to sin anymore and not have to rest in the house of condemnation anymore. Because if you're feeling condemnation, you're going to look for opportunities to separate yourself from people, and Jesus does not want you to do that. He wants you to run to Him. Because here's the thing. He's the Word that became flesh. He's God who came to us. Now, you don't have to go to Him. It's not something that you had to do. He put on humanity and came to you so He can dwell with you. And if you've never done that, I want you to make that your decision today to follow Him and allow Him to dwell in your heart. And if you have done that, I want you to experience a new level of love that includes grace and truth in your relationships. What would it look like if your home or your family or even this church chose to love people like the way Jesus loved without letting go of grace and truth? What would that look like in your relationships? What would that look like in your home? Don't let go of truth or grace. Because a truthless grace means nothing, and a graceless truth only destroys. Will you stand up with me? Lord, as we go into this last worship set, Father, I just ask that You would speak to our hearts and allow us to hear You over the accusing thoughts that we have of ourselves. I pray that You would allow us to hear Your voice over the voices of those who have accused us, over the voices that we may have had in ourselves, of accusing ourselves, saying that we may not be good enough, that we're unlovable. I pray that we would reject those thoughts and reject those things, and we would come to grips with the reality of our sin and run to the grace-giving love that comes from the cross. Because the truth is, I have sinned. The truth is, we have sinned. But instead of us paying the penalty for our sins, you paid the penalty for our sins. And for that, I am graceful. I am grateful. And for that, I choose to receive your grace gift in my life. And I choose to live my life in gratitude to the gift that you've given.